Arnold Taylor for not only having three first names, but also for voicing such unforgettable characters as Leonardo in Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
You don't want to do this.
Johnny Test in the cartoon hit with the same name.
Whatever.
The prehistoric king of cavemen, Fred Flintstone.
Fred, Yabba Dabba.
And Jedi Masters Plo Koon.
Surrender.
And Obi-Wan Kenobi in Star Wars The Clone Wars.
Need some help?
Yet these all pale in comparison to such Herculean characters as this ugly horse-like creature.
Who are you calling ugly?
Or random guy eating an apple.
Is there an echo in here?
Or the unforgettable and irresistible Mini-Wheat.
Hey guys, sorry we're late.
But now, he steps out of the vocal booth for his newest role as host for Star Wars Weekend. Please welcome the small man with the freakish vocal range, James Arnold Taylor.
Soldiers. You know, for me, I could have used a little more cowbell, but, you know, I thought it was good. They were great. Chewbacca, he's crazy. You know, it is so great to be involved in Star Wars Weekends, and to be the host of Star Wars Weekends, what an honor, as the voice of Obi-Wan Kenobi on Star Wars The Clone Wars. And, you know, as a voice actor, we rarely get to kind of come out of the vocal booth, and it is fun to be here. The one thing I get a kick out of is all those different voices, you know, from Fox Tonight, it's The Simpsons. Animation domination starts now. You might hear that, or, you know, you've got Obi-Wan. But the Mini-Wheat, that's what everybody loves, the Mini-Wheat, huh? We love the Mini-Wheat. And he's basically David Spade. Yeah, how you doing? Okay, and you are... okay. That's because he's a pink Mini-Wheat, you know? I'm the only guy brave enough to be the pink Mini-Wheat, huh? Okay. So we're having a great time. We love Star Wars, yes? Fantastic. And it's hot out there, isn't it?
Yeah.
I'll tell you, it makes Tatooine feel like Hoth. It is so hot. Jump across the plate, sorry. Well, we have an amazing show for you, and I want to get right to it because my guests are fantastic, and we go to the dark side and the good side as well today. And my first guest is an action star featured in so many films and television, and just, well, we know him as Darth Maul. Yeah. And for some reason, we love Darth Maul. He's a bad guy. We love him, right? Let's take a look at this man in action. Star Tours?
I have.
Yes?
Quite a few times.
And you enjoy it?
I love it.
Anybody else? Woo! One or two? Woo! Yeah. Now, you've got a little something that's happening after this at 4:45. Now, it is hot out there, so you want to come back to the Premier Theater at 4:45, right? Because we take a visit to the mall with Mr. Ray Park. That has been so much fun for us to do.
That has been. I've really enjoyed playing around with you on stage.
Oh, thank you. Well, for those of you that don't know Visit to the Mall, anybody not seen Visit to the Mall before? Okay, you all have to stay, but look at how many people have. Tell the folks that haven't how good it is, yes? Woo! Thank you. This man is a master of martial arts, and he takes us through his life and his history of all of that, as well as some stories about Darth Maul and so many other famous characters. So I hope everybody comes back and does that. But,
please.
You know, Darth Maul is really one of the best bad guys of all time, I would say, yeah?
Oh, cool.
And, you know, as Obi-Wan Kenobi, I have a certain connection with you. But, yes. But I think that it's really pretty great. How do you feel about that? The fact that people embrace this bad guy. I think so much of that has to do with who you are as a person, right?
Yeah, you know, it's taken me quite a few years. I mean, it's been like 10, 11 years now to get used to being the fact that I played Darth Maul. And in the beginning, I used to get asked the question a lot. And I'd always talk about Darth Maul as the other person, like, as if I never played him in the first place. And then just over the years and having kids of my own and I've been able to share more stories, it's as an actor, I now see the attraction with like being the bad guy. Like there's been times where I wanted to be the good guy in a role, but the bad guy gets to fight everyone and, you know, gets to do more things and more, you know, naughty and crazy things. So I'm still getting used to it, but I'm embracing it and having fun with it.
Your inner Maul. Do you have a fondest, what is your fondest memory of being Darth Maul?
It's just, you know, and one fond memory I have is we were in Tunisia and Liam and I just finished filming Desert Fire, and it was rescheduled because we had these big set of winds and sandstorms and the sets were blown over, so the fight was pushed and we had to film it in the following day. We finished the fight in one morning because we were, you know, it got really hot there, so George called an early wrap, you know, at end of day for the whole set, and we went back to the hotel, and the whole crew were in the pool, and George was there, and I dove in, I remember him just sitting on the side, and I just thought it was really cool, and I was like, hey, George, hey, Mr. Lucas, and I said, was it good? Did I do a good job? Was it good? Because it was a great day, and I remember looking around, and the cast members are there, and we're in this hotel, and in Tunisia, and I thought, this is awesome.
Yeah, it is a wonderful world of Star Wars. And now, speaking of Liam Neeson and Ewan McGregor, you did a lot of training with them, right? For many months, was it? Or
we were on a fight rehearsal for about 2 months before, over 2 months before I was playing Darth Maul. So I was eager to just get on set, be painted up.
Yeah.
In that time, we did many tests and makeup tests to see what would work. And it was fun. I mean, at first, I preferred working with the stunt guys because they were the first team. We worked out the fights, we worked out what we were going to do, and we came up with these different things. But when I got to working with Liam and Ewan, they were the characters, and it gave it so much more for me. And I didn't want to work with stunt guys after that because I had to change my style a little bit and timing, and I wanted to keep it to what we were going to do in front of camera.
We have some footage of you training, I believe, with Ewan McGregor.
He's awesome. That. So warm, it was a summer in the UK, and I was just doing one of my above the head blocks to Leon, and as he would come down, the pole just bent and just smacked me on the head, and I just dropped to the floor. You know, I've never been hit on the head with the pole before, and it was unexpected because we would make sure the whole fight was safe, but designed in a way that you would react, you know, to a move at the last second, so it would look more intense and real, rather than going, block in way before you needed to. It was always last minute blocks.
Yeah.
As if it was, you know, to make it look real, and the pole would just went boom and just bent and smacked on it.
Man. But Darth is so commanding. I love that when you do those flips and stuff, and then you do the whole thing and you point and move the
stuff. That was
so
cool. That was for, you know, because I asked George, I said, when am I going to get to use the Force?
Yeah.
You know, I want to be like Vader and do the squeezy thing and stuff like that. You know? And if you watch it, I'm really happy when I do it because I get to point and finger and I didn't have to be guided in any way on how to do it. I knew how to use the Force in my head. You know? I was told, you know, we've all practiced, and I was told, okay, there's going to be a robot on the floor and you're going to use it to do that. And I said, I can do that in my head. That's not a problem. So it was a finished the butterfly, made it, and I was like, yes, got it, Force moment. So I got it, and George says, there you go, here's your Force moment now.
Oh, that's awesome. Is there anything, if you were to do Darth Maul again, is there anything you would want to do that you didn't get a chance to do?
Yeah, you know, I've seen some images and some designs. I would love to come back and have two double-bladed lightsabers. You know, and for a while there, when I heard a rumor they were going to do episode 3 a few years back, I was practicing with two double-bladed lightsabers. It was bloody hard, you know? But I knew in my mind, I could do this. I'm going to show George, I'm going to make a tape. And I'd love to do, like, the, you know, the topless scene, that shot with tattoos all over. And,
yeah.
And just maybe make him a little bit, you know, menacing.
And some metal legs, I would suppose.
Maybe some robotic legs and...
Wow. Well, we have some questions for you, and I know that there's one in particular. There might be someone that's coming in, actually, to ask you a question there. It's my good friend, R2. R2, how are you, my friend? You good? Yes. Oh, and you have a question for Mr. Park, yes? Oh, I see. Well, you know, R2 says that you're a master of martial arts and weaponry, yes?
Sometimes.
He's wondering if you could make anything into a deadly weapon.
I'm sure I can, yes.
So if I, for example, had, say...
Oh, yes.
Something.
Let me show you.
Okay.
Now, I call this the tickle to death.
And is this your revenge on Obi-Wan Kenobi right now?
Humor me just for one moment.
Right.
I'm going to, like, pretend to do a movie fight scene.
Okay.
I'll do a nice flourish here, and then I would...
Stop.
I would finish again.
I have a bad feeling about this, yes. Very nice. Okay.
I like these. These are... First, I'd make sure I clean a few bathrooms with these first.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Now I do have a bad feeling about this.
And then I'd have them dripping wet, and I would just swing them like crazy towards you.
Oh, get them out!
And it's called the art of fighting without fighting, like Bruce Lee would say. And I have to lift a finger, I just have to pretend I'm crazy, like I know what I'm doing. And then...
Very nice.
Thank you.
Yes. All right, Arthur. Don't fight Anakin. I'm sure he's off to something. Don't do it. Yes. Very good. Arthur, needs you, ladies and gentlemen. Very good.
You know, if acting doesn't work out for me, I'll be a janitor. Something.
Yeah.
You know, I'll be pretty good.
So now, another weapon you use is a sword, or two, or more,
yes,
as Snake Eyes. Any Snake Eyes fans out there?
Yeah.
How was it to play such a beloved good guy of something that, you know, we grew up with G.I. Joe. And so here you are in G.I. Joe and you are Snake Eyes. How was that?
It's an awesome feeling. I mean, as a kid, I always played the good guy. When we role played and we were playing superheroes, I always wanted to be the good guy. So I became this bad guy, playing bad guy roles in my acting career. And so, to me, to play Snake Eyes and to be a ninja and to be the ninja warrior that I wanted to be as a kid, I don't care if I never play another good guy role again in my life, because Snake is the one good guy that I'm really proud of, and I get to sort of get back into my inner childhood with Snake Eyes.
Yeah.
You know, and play around with ninja weapons and, you know, the whole, you know, pretending to be a ninja and freezing, you know, and doing a ninja walk, you know. You know, and if there's a move that sounds, you go. You know?
Stuff like that.
Why does it look so much better when he does it than when I do? Just doesn't look like that.
Yeah, they're scary, James. Yeah. Move along.
Well, we have a clip of you in action this day, guys. A little behind the scenes here. Let's take a look at the screens.
When our master was killed, you took a vow of silence. Now you will die without a word.
Storm Shadow and Snake Eyes is really the thing of legends, you know? And they have a blood vendetta that is really one of the strongest I've seen on film.
Well, Snake Eyes is possibly the most important character in the G.I. Joe camp. When you go in knowing that, you know that you have to pay particular care, both in the way that he's represented, in the way that he's written, certainly in the way that he's costumed, because these are the areas that you really have to get right for the camp.
I knew that there had to be a climactic battle between Snake Eyes and Storm Shadow. It's an epic story set within our story about these two guys who met each other when they were kids.
Snake Eyes took a vow of silence because of the death of his master, and that really interests me as an actor, because I really do like to use my body in a physical way. He's just a phenomenal character in comics and cartoons, that growing up as a kid, I wanted to be like that. You know, so whenever I saw an injured movie or a martial art movie and the guys were bouncing off the walls, I wanted to be like those guys. Wielding shiny blades and spinning at each other and flipping and bouncing and jumping and breaking. You know, I get to do a little bit of body popping and breaking in there, so it was fun. That was my little Darth Maul moment there. You know what, for X-Men told, I do my Darth Maul. I also did it for Snakey as well.
So. It's like a little signature you fit.
It's a little thing too for fans to take, you know.
And
take.
He'll be back. You're doing G.I. Joe 2.
Soon.
And he's reprising his role as Snake Eyes. Great call,
thank you guys. Thank you everyone.
Well, now our second guest is Star Wars royalty. Truly, and he's created one of the most beloved characters in the entire Star Wars saga. Take a look at the screens.
If I had this lot.
Can you tell us just briefly what happened there?
This happened a
couple of weeks ago, the AC tendon, the tendon there, I fell over. I wasn't drunk. not that I remember. Not that I remember. We were up in Detroit and fell over. Got up next morning. Up like a balloon.
Wow.
So came home, went to an emergency room. They found that the AC, tendons had almost broken.
Oh my goodness.
So, a very clever doctor, tied them all together, and here we are at Disneyland.
Well, fantastic. We are so grateful. We're very, very grateful. So, I've got to ask you, how does it feel to be truly one of the most beloved, now we have one of the most beloved bad guys, but also one of the most beloved good guys in movie history? How does that feel?
It's grown. It grew on people because of the generations. You know this.
Yeah.
Each generation has it. Each movies have their own characters. And each generation is brought up on that particular character.
Yeah.
It's just, you know, after the... when Empire was being cast, we knew we got something pretty good.
Yes.
And it gradually just crept forward and forward. And it's, you know, now we're talking three generations.
It is fantastic.
So it's fabulous.
And everybody loves Chewbacca. Lawrence Kasdan, a very talented man himself that had a little something to do there with Empire, he had some very kind things to say about you. Well, let's take a look at the screens and hands.
I always thought that Chewie was like the warmest character in the whole saga. You know, he's like a plush toy, you know, a gigantic plush toy. And he's like a dog, really, and I have a dog, and I am devoted to my dog, and a lot of people are. And this is a dog that, you know, not only are you devoted to him, but he's completely devoted to his master, to his son, you know. And when he thinks things have gone horribly wrong, he reacts the way any feeling, you know, emotional dog would, which is he howls. When he's confused, he whimpers and makes those sounds. When he's angry, he defends his, you know, people that he's alone. He's a giant, soft-hearted dog. Chewie was, in a way, always my favorite character.
Absolutely. You know what it is? It's how many hundreds of times have we seen those clips? And I still get a lump in my throat, Peter. Mm-hmm. And it's from your acting and doing those movements. When those doors closed, that was not in the script, right?
That was in the script, but it was a very almost single line thing.
Okay.
That they decided, they made the decision that nobody was going out that night to look for who the guys outside. And then we did the scene with the ladder, and suddenly you hear a complete silent stage, and then someone goes bang with the two doors close. I think we did that about three times.
Okay.
And each time I see it now, I still get along, you know, as much as anybody.
Oh, that's great.
In my throat. And it's one of the nicer parts of that particular character.
Oh, I've got to say also, you know, this last year we had 30 years of Empire Strikes Back, and I was privileged to be with you at the Hollywood screening there where we did for St. Jude's, and Harrison Ford was there, and from the stage, Harrison was talking about what a joy it was. And was that on your birthday, I believe it was?
Yep.
And he was saying what a joy it was to work with you. How was that? Was there kind of a kinship there that, you know, the two of you?
Well, there has to be.
Yeah.
To, you know, any two actors have to correspond with each other into those particular characters. Otherwise, it just doesn't work. And that works throughout the original trilogy. And it just works. And, you know, you're there, you're doing things, and you're making stuff up.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, George is very nice about it. He will change stuff. And Harrison had some very good comments to do. You know, some of the scripts that George wrote were, as you know, were terrible. But when I say terribly, they were terribly technical.
Yes.
So, I got out of that one.
You skimmed the water there. Yes. You got it out of it. Yes, looking good. Yeah, well, so now we do have we have many questions here. We do have one on video that someone had a question for you. Would you mind taking a look at the screens, everyone, and maybe see if you can answer this question for us? Okay, Peter, Mark has some questions he really wants to know.
Yeah, I'm the blush when I ask this, but do people realize that as Chewbacca that he's naked? I mean, do you have those things that they have, you know, the protection, you pull it down and you put it on the seat of the Millennium Falcon and you sit on it? Like, I just don't know. How do you carry your keys around? Are there keys in the Millennium Falcon? Do you have the little stretchy thing? Or you keep it in your purse. Keys are in the purse. I know it's in the purse. Keys are in the purse. Keys are in the purse.
So glad I asked.
Yes.
So are the keys to the Millennium Falcon in the purse?
Yep.
Chewbacca's purse? Oh, boy. Okay.
Yes.
Now, let me ask you about that costume and also, but not just that, but speaking. Was there ever a time on set where you were speaking?
Occasionally.
Yeah.
But they hid it quite well. And uh-huh. There's one section where we're talking about Obi-Wan.
Oh, yes.
The quote is, "The old man's mad." So, you know, that was one of the... Someone had to start it off.
Right.
Dewey puts his big foot in it every time. So, he goes there.
You know, we actually have that footage. Do you want to look and take a listen to Mr. Peter Mayhew?
"The old man's mad."
He said, "Chewie, boy, where'd you dig up that old fossil?"
"That is a great man."
"Yeah, great if he must have been trouble."
"I didn't hear you give any ideas."
And there you are. Wow. So now, it's so fun to see that footage, isn't it? You know, outside of the normal. But we have some other times where you were talking as Chewbacca. Let's see if you remember this one. Take a look at this.
"Hey! I'm cold."
When you think about that, that was in the middle of Norway in April with about minus 50 degrees.
So it was cold.
Snow up to your elbows, everything like that. Oh. And all I got at home is a Wookiee suit, yeah. a Wookiee skin. Everybody else has got snow boots, equipment.
All the gear.
And then someone comes up and asks you whether you're warm enough.
Yeah, of course I am. Okay.
"Of course I am. Can't you see me sweating?"
Now, how about this one here? There's another one where you were talking.
"Sorry, am I interrupting anything?"
"What's up, Maya?"
You were Billy D. And then I think we actually have one other spot where you were talking in studio.
"Chewie?
Hi.
Take care. Okay?
Okay. All right then. Boogie on!" I love you.
That last one, where with Mark, was pure putting off last minute shot. He's saying goodbye to everybody, Chewie's working away, and Kurt goes, "Grab it."
That's awesome.
Oh, Mark.
So he really wasn't expecting it. Oh, that is great.
As I say, things come along and things happen, and they go down in history, which is what we're talking about today.
Absolutely. And we do have another question. I think we have one from someone in the audience.
No.
Chewbacca, how are you? You have a question for Mr. Peter Mayhew? Yes? That's a great question. And that relates to me as well, Chewbacca. Okay, thank you very much. Chewie is wondering what you think of your role in the new Star Wars The Clone Wars animated series.
It's all
pretty good.
It's all okay. It was a great honor to be asked to do the cartoon series. It was wonderful to to be able to join up everything, you know, Yoda and the other Wookiees on all the planets. So it was great.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
I enjoyed it.
Oh, very cool. Thank you, Chewbacca. Mm-hmm. Ladies and gentlemen, let's hear it for Chewbacca, huh? Thank you, Joey. Thanks for your question. And, you know, Chewbacca, we have a video, actually, of Peter getting ready and meeting with all the folks up at Skywalker Ranch. So let's take a look at the screens. Are you going to stay? Okay, great. Thank you.
Joey, is that you? This, of course, is my friend Peter Mayhew. You would know him as Chewy. And since we're doing something really special on our show involving our good friend Chewy, I thought it was completely inappropriate if we went any farther than we have without involving the man himself.
That's the real trick, isn't it?
It's body language and eye language. Chewy has a peculiar walk, which is unique to me. You know, it's the angle, it's the not me approach. Yes. You know, you watch me walk, is Chewy to the T.
Yeah, we can show you some of the work we've done on it.
Yeah.
Up a big rock.
Right.
What is that?
It's a Wookiee.
That is correct. When he comes around and they say, what's that? There's something there.
Yeah.
Gradually, as he unfolds, you see his hair come back, and it's Wookiee.
You know, with you and George, I know when you watch it, you'll know the difference. There's a certain way the character is, and it's not just the big, hairy Sasquatch guy. There's a real character there.
Everything is right. The face is great. You guys have done a wonderful job.
All right, Chewbacca, great question. Thank you, Chewie.
Thank you, Chewie.
Let's hear it from Chewie. Fantastic. Wow, it has been such an honor, though, because that, the Clone Wars, that was the final one for our season, and it was so great. And it has been such an honor, as well, to have you both here. And, you know, it is Disney, and it is Star Wars weekends, and we have kind of a tradition here of ending things. And I have some ears for you there. And, sir, if you wouldn't mind, yes. Okay. And I'm going to put mine on. And Ray, could you join us over here?
I'd love to.
We need to do this in true Disney fashion for all of you, because we've had so much fun. And, you know, pretty good, right? Not too bad, these gentlemen. The most fun in Star Wars history, I think. All right, so you guys know your parts, yes?
Yeah.
I'm going to go to you first, then to you. All right, very good. And a little music, maestro, please.
Now it's time to